Happy Resurrection Sunday. Come on, give the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords an ovation of praise. He is risen. Come on, he is risen. Amen, amen. He's risen indeed. We want to welcome you to City Church. Thank you for being with us today. I'm Pastor Steve Tott, and I'm the lead pastor here at City Church. And we're thankful that you're here today to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
You know what I love most about the resurrection is not just the story, not just the account of it that we see in the scriptures. That's beautiful. But what I love is that what the resurrection of Jesus brings to you and I.
Yeah.
Come on, because he didn't want to leave us in a place of death, but he determined by the 2,000 years ago on a cross, he went to a cross and he paid the price for our sins. And but how many know he 3 days later, come on, today we celebrate it, he rose again. Yeah. It wasn't possible that death would keep him.
That's
come
right.
on, somebody. It wasn't possible that the grave could hold him. Amen. And he loves you today. And if you're here today, I believe you're going to experience God's grace and his love today. Amen. And so we want to thank you for being here. I need you to pray for my voice. You see what's, you know, it sounds like I'm a teenager going through puberty, but that's not what's happening. I'm 50 something, 50 and none of your business. I'm 50 and none of your business. Amen. Amen. But we're going to pray. Why don't you stand with us? If you're a guest in the house today, we just want to say thank you for being a first-time guest. And if you'll scan the bulletin, you got a QR code in there. You can fill out a Connect card. And if you'll go back to the Connect Center, they'll know that you filled that out, and they will give you a gift. Also, you can use the Connect card in the seat back in front of you. And let me make you aware of just a couple of things happening today, okay? Next steps are happening April 16th. So if you are new to the church and you end up deciding that you like it and you are interested in getting involved and finding out more, you could sign up for Next Steps today. Also, Ray of Hope Food Pantry. Our food pantry here at the church serves this month, April 17th and 18th. There we go. Y'all say, Pastor, you need help with them bifocals. Amen. Amen. And so I just wanted to make you aware of those couple things. We're going to go ahead and pray opening today, and then we're going to get right into worship. I'm going to be coming back in just a little while to share today's Easter message with you, and I believe you're going to be blessed as I share it today. Amen. Let's bow our heads for prayer this morning. Gracious Heavenly Father, we just come before you today in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we give you all the praise and the honor and the glory.
Yes, we do.
I thank you because you alone are worthy of it. And Lord, today we just celebrate the resurrection of the Son of God, that he was sitting at the right hand of the Father today, making intercession for us. And Father, today as we celebrate that resurrection, God, let that resurrection life lift us from a place, God, maybe of a discouragement. Maybe it needs to lift us from a place of complacency. Maybe it needs to lift us from a place of depression, Father. Whatever it is, Father, let your resurrection power be manifested in this place today. And may you touch every heart and every life. And may each person walk out of this place different than what we've came. We pray it all today in the name that's above every name. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's worship together.
Do you hear the good news?
Woo!
He is risen.
Yes. Amen.
Let's testify the good news. Run forever.
Thank you. Welcome, everyone. You can have a seat for a moment. Now it's time for offering. I just wanted to remind you, too, that the Connect card is in the seat in front of you. If you want to fill it out, any newcomers or people who need to change their address or phone number will be in the back, and we have a gift for you. So we're going to take up offering now if our ushers want to come. So you can give the traditional way, which is in the seat in front of you, by check or cash. You can do the QR code, or you can do text to give, which is 84321. And just a reminder that, you know, offering, giving of our tithes and our offering is part of our worship, and that's why we do it during the worship service. So Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this time that we can be together, God, and just to celebrate your resurrection, Father. And we just pray, that God, that you will bless the tithe, bless those who have to give and those who don't have to give, God, and just pray that it'll further your kingdom for you. You are worthy, and we give you the praise.
This next song is...
Hey, I'm Cherie Engel, director of Ray of Hope Food Pantry. We are a mission outreach of City Church, and we are serving in April on the 17th and the 18th. If you'd like to donate money, food, your time as a volunteer, please see me or Joyce Graham, our assistant director.
If you find yourself asking yourself, what do I do now? If you are recently saved and you want to know what your next steps are, we can help. We have next steps and a meal on April 23rd following service. So if you are interested in finding out your next steps, as in baptism or, you know, should I get involved? Do I volunteer? Those kind of things. We definitely can help. So stop by and see Ben and I at the Connect Center. We have a sign-up sheet, and we can also answer questions for you. So come and see us.
We are all super excited for Pastor Appreciation Day. It's going to be held on April 30th right here at City Church. We're going to have a wonderful special service followed with a luncheon. We are also asking that everybody come together and show Pastor Steve and Terry how much we actually appreciate them as a whole and individually. We are taking love offerings. You can do so with your tithing envelope by putting love offering for your Pastor Terry and Pastor Steve. You can also do it by the Connect Center with the QR code. And you can also do it by texting PASTOR to 84321. One other way that you can do a love offering is through our Church Center app. We hope to see each and every one of you there.
Hey, what's up, everybody? Pastor TJ here with City Youth, letting you guys know that we have youth group every Wednesday at 7 p.m. right here at City Church. If you're in grade 6 through 12, come out Wednesday and join us. It's going to be so much fun. Can't wait to see you.
We'd like to welcome all of our first-time visitors. Come see us at the Connect Center to fill out a Connect card. You can also fill it out digitally by scanning the QR code that's in your bulletin. All of our longtime attenders, if you need to update your information, you can also do this by scanning the QR code or by filling out a Connect card.
And that does it for your morning announcements.
Well, as I was saying, this is an older song, or it's a newer song with an older twist. And it's called This Is My Song. And I believe that it's your song, too.
That's right.
So just if you want to stand again. I know we're not a Catholic church, but I mean, if you want to stand and go up and down, whatever. But anyway. I remember those melodies, the words we sang when I first believed. Songs of redemption, stories of love, heaven awakened inside my soul, and I sing it. Jesus paid.
Christ is my song. Praise Him, my Savior, all day long. Blessed assurance will we be mine. Hallelujah, Jesus is mine. This is my story. This is my
Now, if that didn't wake you up, I don't know what would.
Thank you.
me to my knees. It's like holy water, you're the
Mary.
Came to worship today.
Yeah.
Amen. He is risen. Amen.
Yeah,
you can go ahead and be seated this morning. God bless you. Thank you, praise team. Man, you feel his presence in this place today?
Yes. Amen.
Yes. Amen. If they wouldn't have stopped playing, we'd have just been singing that until Jesus comes back again. But it's good to be here today. Happy Easter to you. Look at the person next to you and tell them, you look good today. Man, you look good today. Hallelujah. I want to thank you for being here. And, man, God's got some great things in store. For those of you that got kids, if you didn't get a chance to check them in and you want to send them to kids' church, you could still make your ways right out the double doors. And, Miss Wendy, if your kids are six and older, they'll be in that room to the right, okay? And there should be someone out there to help you. Miss Wendy's right there in the hallway. Just to let you parents know that, okay, if you want to avail yourselves and allow them to go to kids' church, okay? We have a kids' church for all ages back there today, all right? Well, praise the Lord. I'm excited to preach on the resurrection today. Amen. Man, Jesus is risen. Yeah, I began a sermon series last week simply entitled Back to the Basics. And I believe that it's time for the church in 2023 to get back to the basics. Amen. Come on, the basics of the gospel. The basics of preaching the gospel, the glorious gospel of grace, the gospel of love. Come on, somebody. And that's why Jesus, God so loved the world, come on, that he gave his son. We just believe in him. We don't have to perish, but have everlasting life. Man, so in this series, Back to the Basics, I started it last week. And if you want to go back to watch last week's sermon, you can you can download our Church Center app. I don't know if they mentioned that yet today, but you go to the App Store, Google App Store, or to your Apple App Store if you're from, you know, if you got Apple. If you go there, download Church Center app. When you download it, it will just, when you open it up, it'll give you an option to put in a zip code. And when you put that in, all the churches will come up in this area. If you just favorite us, then every time you hit the app, it'll go right to us. Does that make sense? So So listen, make sure you download the Church Center app and avail yourself to that as well. We've got a lot of things happening here at City Church, so you can look at your bulletins. But today, before we go out and the kids have a good time at an Easter hunt, and before we go eat some ham, come on. Aren't you glad we're under a new and better covenant? Come on, somebody. We get ham and bacon and, come on, somebody. Right? Ribs and shrimp. And so you couldn't eat all that stuff in the Old Testament. It was sin. Right? It was part of the law. You couldn't eat those unclean foods. And so I'm thankful for a new and better covenant that came through Jesus 2,000 years ago. Amen. If you have your Bibles today, go ahead and turn with me to Mark's Gospel, chapter number 16 and verse 1. Mark's Gospel, chapter number 16 and verse 1. I want to read the Easter story this morning, the resurrection story this morning. And from that, we're going to find some things out that are going to apply to our lives today, because it's great to know that Jesus rose from the dead 2,000 years ago. But it's even better for you to rise from the dead in 2023. Amen. It's even better for you to discover the life in Christ in 2023. Amen. And so that's what we believe God is going to do today. Amen. Let's read this story together. Mark chapter 16 and verse 1. If you, will you do me one more favor? Will you stand with me one more time for the reading of the Word of God today? Listen, after this, listen, it's on you if you stand after this, all right? Mark's Gospel chapter 16 and verse 1. Now when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James and Salome, bought spices that they might come and anoint him. Very early in the morning on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb when the sun had risen. And they said among themselves, "Who will roll away the stone from the door of the tomb for us?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone had been rolled away, for it was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a white robe sitting on the right side. And they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him? But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him as he said to you." And so they went out quickly and fled from the tomb, for they were trembling and amazed. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Now when he arose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven demons. And when she went and told those who had been with him, as they'd mourned and wept, and when they heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, they did not believe. And after that, he appeared in another form to two of them as they walked and went into the country. And they told, and they went and told it to the rest, but they did not believe them. And later he appeared to the 11 as they sat at the table, and he rebuked their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they did not believe those who had seen him after he had risen. And he said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel," or good news, "to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned." Amen, amen. And I want to read one more passage in your hearing. Romans chapter 8 and verse 11. Here's what's important as well. Listen. "But if the same Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwells in you." Come on, give him a hand clap of praise. You may be seated this morning. As I look in the resurrection story, a lot of times people try to prove the resurrection of Jesus. The greatest proof of the resurrection of Jesus is the resurrected life. Come on, somebody that has been in a place of death and has experienced a place of despair and has experienced a place in their lives where they didn't even know what their future might have held. But God had something in store for you. And as I look at the story and as I look at the text, there are these different witnesses that we see that attest to the fact that Jesus did historically raise from the dead. Amen. We find out that the ladies, as they go to the tomb and they find the empty tomb, when they go back and tell the disciples, Mary Magdalene and them, tell them, and they did not believe them. Another account in the text that I read to you says that there were two walking down the road. This is the ones in Luke's gospel that are walking down the road of Emmaus, and Jesus begins to walk with them, and as he begins to preach, they don't recognize what he looks like, but they recognize the words coming out of his mouth, and all of a sudden their hearts begin to burn. They've seen him resurrected. Then the 11, the Bible says, seeing him, he appears to them as they are gathered together in the upper room, and he appears to them and he rebuked their unbelief and their hardness of hearts because they did not believe those who had told them that they'd seen him risen. If that weren't enough, the Bible says that there were over 500 eyewitness accounts of the resurrection of Jesus, is what Paul said in his writings. And I've come to tell you and just put to rest the fact that the Jews still say to this day that the disciples stole away his body. Can I tell you, the disciples couldn't have possibly stolen away his body. It wasn't possible for the grave to keep him. It wasn't possible for the tomb to hold him. Come on, somebody. He said, I lay my life down, and if I lay it down, I've got the power to pick it back up. Yeah, he said, I've got the power to pick it back up. This Jesus, this wonderful Savior that we were singing about. Hallelujah. Him. And when I look into the story, I want to go back to what I talked about on our Palm Sunday last week. Remember last Sunday, I preached the first installment of the series Back to Basics. But I talked about revealing Jesus, and we looked at the revelation of Jesus. We look at what Jesus looks like and how God revealed him to the Jews as he made his triumphal entry. But today, I'm going to preach part two of revealing Jesus, because today, in revealing Jesus, we're revealing the resurrection. How many of you know that John's gospel, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life? I talk about revealing the resurrection. I'm talking about revealing Jesus. Jesus Christ and him crucified, him and him alone. How many of you know that he is enough? He's enough. Amen, amen. Listen, if we're going to get back to the basics, family, one of the things we're going to have to do, the first thing that God wants us to know today, is that we're going to have to get back to the fact that the resurrection reveals who Jesus is. There's a lot of confusion as to who Jesus is if you were to ask even around this room. I talked about this and touched about this last week. But the reality is there's a different proclamation from each person in this room of who Jesus is. Last Sunday I talked about, as they were making the triumphal entry, everybody was shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna, Son of David. And yet in the next breath they turned around and they said, who is this? See, when they proclaimed that he was the Son of David, they were proclaiming that he was the Messiah, the long-awaited one, the one that had been prophesied about. Amen. The one that was to come to redeem Israel. Yeah. Amen. And in that, you know, the triumphal entry, it's revealing the Messiah. And that's what we talked about last week. But the next, very next breath, they said, who is this? Is he just a prophet from Galilee? Who is this Jesus? Look at the person next to you and say, who is this Jesus? I'm so thankful that the Bible paints a clear picture, aren't you? I'm so thankful that we have the prophets that prophesied about the coming of Christ thousands of years, hundreds of years before he came. Listen to this one. Ezekiel chapter 53 and verse 9. I want to start reading to you today, because the Bible tells us who this is. The Bible says that there was no form or no comeliness that we should be attracted to him. We hid our, as it were, our faces from him, the first part of Isaiah 53 says. But he was wounded for our transgressions, and that's how we know it's Jesus. He was bruised for our iniquities. The punishment of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we're healed. And we get down to Isaiah 53 in chapter and verse 9. And it says this, and they made his grave with the wicked. Listen to this. This is the prophet Isaiah prophesying hundreds of years before Christ's coming. Listen, they made his grave with the wicked, but with the rich at his death. Come on, somebody. They made his grave with the wicked and with the rich at his death. How many of you know that a man by the name of Joseph of Arimathea gave one of the premier tombs for Jesus? You know why? Because he knew it wasn't that big of a sacrifice, because he knew he'd only be borrowing it for the weekend. Amen. Yeah. But he was buried with the wicked, but he was raised with the rich. He was buried with the rich at his death. Because he had done no violence, nor, listen, was any deceit found in his mouth. But yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, and he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. And you shall see the, and he shall see the labor of his soul and be satisfied. But his knowledge, by his knowledge, my righteous servant shall justify many. Say, I'm one of the many. Listen to this. For he shall bear their sins, their iniquities. Amen. Isaiah prophesied about it hundreds of years. David in Psalm chapter 16, he said, you won't leave my body in the grave, and you won't leave my soul in Sheol. It is a prophecy in Psalm 16 of Jesus' coming. Jesus himself says in Matthew chapter 12 and verse 40, Jesus is talking to the believers, the Jewish believers. And he's talking to them, the Jewish leaders rather. And as he's talking to them, he lets them know something. Because they were wanting to know when the kingdom was going to be established. And he said they were asking for a sign of it, the sign of the coming of the kingdom. And this is what Jesus said. He says they're not going to get any sign, this evil and wicked generation. But rather, Matthew 12:40 says, for as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Come on, somebody. I'm talking about the resurrection reveals who Jesus is. Jesus goes a little bit further than that in John chapter 11 and verse 25. In John 11 and 25, Jesus says to her, see, Jesus had went to raise Lazarus from the dead. How many of you know that was the one that really ticked the religious leaders off? You know why? Because Lazarus had been in the tomb for 4 days. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the Pharisees were the sect that believed in the resurrection, but they believed that the spirit left the body after 3 days. And for a manifestation of a raised from the dead person to manifest on the fourth day, they were confused. And they knew that it could only point to the Messiah. Amen. And as this happens, the Bible says that Jesus, he goes to his friend Lazarus, and when he gets there, the sisters appear to him. And they said, Lord, Lord, if you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. Come on, how many have ever felt like that? God, if you'd have just showed up, this wouldn't have happened. But he said, for my glory, I have allowed this, that the glory of God may be revealed. He looks at him, he says, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, yet shall he live. And he who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Do you believe it? See, the reality is that none of us are perfect. That's why Jesus came. Brother Keith's not perfect. Norm's not perfect. My wife's not perfect. And I sure ain't perfect as your pastor. But I'm so thankful that I serve one who is perfect. I serve one whose blood was flawless. It was clean. It was spotless. And it paid the price for our sins. Amen. You see, he who believes in him. Where's your faith today? Is your faith in your job? Is your faith in how well your family is going? Is your faith in your finances? Come on, is your faith in the economy or in the government? Can I tell you that every single one of those things will let you down? But there is a God in heaven that created you, that's blessed you, that's given you everything you have, and he wants you to know who he is today. It's not enough to know who I say he is. You've got to know who he is. Who is this Jesus? Who is this Jesus? That's what he asked his disciples. Hallelujah. Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Peter looks at him and says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus looks at him and says, flesh and blood hasn't revealed this to you, but my Father, which is in heaven, Peter, and on this rock, I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. On what revelation? On what rock? The rock, the revelation of who he is to you. Who do you say he is? Because the world is, they're dying to know. I heard a story of a man that was in line at a restaurant, at a fast food restaurant, you know, not a real restaurant, just the kind we Americans go to. And as he's standing in line, on the back of his shirt, it just said, Jesus paid it all. And the guy just, he tapped him on the shoulder. He says, what's your shirt say on the back? He said, Jesus paid it all. He paid the price for everything. Paid the price for all of the sins of humanity. And this is what he said. He said, why has anyone never told me that before? I think that's the question that God is asking us. Who is he to you? Because you've got something to say. You've got someone to tell. You've got someone to encourage and pray for and to speak the truth over their lives. Amen. And it will bring life and bring it to the full. See, Jesus is the one. We've got to introduce people to Jesus. You know, don't tell them to come see Pastor Steve. He's a great preacher. You know, that, I appreciate that, but that's all right. Don't tell them that. You know, tell them to come meet Jesus. Tell them there's a God in heaven that hasn't wrote them off. Tell them that know how far they've gone in their sin and how far they feel away from God and how far that they feel just so lost and they feel so empty and they feel depressed and it feels like their life's in shambles. Can I tell you, it's that one that Jesus says, oh, just come to me. Hallelujah. Just come to me, all you who are weary and you carry heavy burdens, and I'll give you rest. Amen. Amen. And it's this Jesus that I want you to know today. Secondly, if we're going to get back to the basics, we got to get back to the idea that the resurrection reveals what Jesus has provided. What Jesus has provided. The Bible says that he has given us everything that pertains to life and godliness. I don't know how. What did I do? Did anyone see me drop my handkerchief? Golly. Give me a towel. Give me a towel. Hallelujah. All right, it'll show up. The resurrection reveals what Jesus has provided. Amen. You see, the Bible tells us that God made a provision for our sins. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Charlie boy. That's my good-looking little grandboy right there. My youngest good-looking grandboy. Then there's my oldest good-looking grandboy. Then there's my second youngest grandboy. Then there's my middle grandboy right there. Yeah. All seven of my grandchildren, all four of my girls are here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus does still do miracles. Amen. The resurrection reveals what Jesus provided. You know what the Bible says, that without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. Pastor Keith talked about this on Friday when he preached a very powerful Good Friday service. Because it was a special kind of blood, Keith. It was a sinless blood. See, sacrifices have been made for sin since the beginning. When Adam sinned in the beginning, God slew or sacrificed an animal, and he clothed him in the skin and wrapped him in the blood. And I want you to think about that for a minute. Why would God do that? Because nothing can live without blood. Amen. You can't live without blood. It's impossible. Right? The life of the flesh is in the blood, and the flesh is what houses our spirit. Listen, there is no life without blood. And so it's a spiritual principle as well that God gave us blood as a spiritual atonement for our sins. Amen? Through the precious blood of Jesus. The Bible says in Revelation 13 and 8, it tells us something significant, because sometimes we think that when man fell, when Adam fell, that somehow God came up with an alternate plan. You ever thought that before? I used to think that when I was a brand new Christian. Man, God, man, he came up with an alternate good plan. How do you know that? Listen, y'all, he created the end from the beginning. Listen to this. Revelation 13, 8 says, he was the lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. Did you hear me? I said he was the lamb that was slain before this world was ever created. That's right. Yeah. The resurrection reveals what he provided. He provided it. Listen, Jesus was the perfect sacrifice. There had been hundreds and hundreds and thousands upon thousands of sacrifices for the children of Israel. They would come in and they would make these sacrifices, but nothing would remove the sin. All it did was cover it up. Just like man did in the beginning when he sinned, he covered himself with a fig leaf and tried to hide. Why? Because your sin, it separates you, the Bible says, from God. Not once you're a believer, it don't, but listen to me. Your sin will always try to come between you and God. Amen? Yeah, the resurrection reveals the slain lamb. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7 says, in him we have redemption through his blood. You know what that means? God purchased you. God bought you. Some of you feel like you have no worth, no value, no potential. You feel like you have no created value. Listen to me. God saw value in you from the cross. God valued you so much that he sent the life of his son. Come on, somebody. I wish I had a church to give God some praise this morning. He said, this is how much I value you. I so love the world. He redeemed us. He purchased us. He bought us. Listen, we have a brand new covenant, which means a brand new contract. Amen. And all that is in that covenant is ours. Every promise in God, listen, is yes. And it's amen. Because in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sin. Watch this. According to the riches of his grace. Grace has always been the gospel, family. Grace is the good news. Listen, the mercy of God is amazing as well, right? Come on. The mercy of God is when God don't give you what you deserve. That's mercy. Come on, how many of you had mercy on your children sometimes? Children, how many of you want your parents to be merciful sometimes? Right? Yeah, his mercy. His mercy, listen, his mercy is amazing. But his grace is something totally different, because grace is when God gives you what you don't deserve. He gives you his love. He gives you acceptance. Listen, he gives you a new identity. He gives you your true identity in him. He gives you forgiveness of sin and righteousness. Hallelujah. He's given us so much. So much has been provided through the Christ. It's through his grace. Some of you are struggling with your struggle. Quit struggling with your struggle. Just receive the grace. Who am I preaching to? I said, some of you are struggling with the struggling. Quit struggling with the struggle. Just receive the grace. I ain't perfect. If I was perfect, I wouldn't be here. Amen. But I'm so glad that I have the perfect one living down on the inside of me, Sister Barb. I'm so glad that the life of God lives on the inside of me, that the life of Jesus, that his spirit. See, you are created in your spirit. Do you realize that? You are a spirit. Your body is not what makes you who you are. Think about that for a moment. We can see our loved ones that we love, and they can be alive on machines, but they're not there. Are you with me? Because the body can be alive, but if the spirit is gone, that's really where the life comes from. The spirit is really who you are. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. He's got a great voice. Let him be a preacher one day, Lord. Even so, in Jesus' mighty name, Micah, you'll preach the gospel. What are you going to do? John 10:10 tells us the revelation of what the resurrection brings. This resurrection revealed what Jesus has provided. And how many of you know that John 10:10 says that the thief comes but to steal, to kill, and to destroy? Let me tell you something. The devil ain't playing games. And so you better quit playing games with your sin. I said it. I'm a new covenant preacher, and I believe in the power of the gospel. I do. It is the gospel of God is the power of God unto salvation to them that believe. But to believe, you've got to believe that God's way is right and your way is wrong. Amen. You've got to believe the life-giving word that Jesus gives you on how that life comes. Amen. Because in this text in John chapter 10, verse 10, you know what was happening? In John 10:10, the Bible says that Jesus tells a parable. And he tells a parable about a sheep keeper. And he says that there are those that have tried to climb up over the wall or the gate of the sheep pen. And he says to them, they are thieves and robbers. And he starts to describe them. He starts to describe all their works and all that they think they are. And then he says, and the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Can I tell you, just as big of a thief as the devil is religion? Come on, somebody. For you to be bound up in religious tradition, for you to be bound in religion and works, for you to be have a pharisaical spirit where you can look down your long pointy nose at somebody else. But let me tell you something, honey. Every time you point your finger at somebody, baby, you got three of them pointing right back at you. The thieves come. The devil. The thief. Religion. Listen, it's not about you just showing up on Easter. That's religion. It's not just about you showing up on Christmas. That's religion. No, it's about desiring to be in the house of God because you have believed in the one that died for you. And you've surrendered your life to him. And you've said, God, I need your help to do this thing, to live this Christian life. Because God, you know how I am and how I get, God. Who am I preaching to this morning? Amen. Amen. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And the enemy wants to just tear up your life. He wants to destroy you. He wants to destroy your family. He wants to destroy your marriage. He wants to destroy your whole life. He wants to destroy your children's future. Hallelujah. But listen to what Jesus said. But, somebody say the word but changes everything. The word but negates everything that came before. Are you with me? The thieves come to steal, kill, and to destroy, but I've come that you might have life and you might have it to the full. Let me tell you something. If you're not in a church that's preaching life, if the message the preacher's preaching at your church isn't preaching life, run. Run as fast as you can, because I've watched too many generations come up under a standard of law and legalism and being preached the Ten Commandments to them, and then them trying to live up to a standard that only Jesus could fulfill. And Jesus said that has passed away. Hey, new baby. What's up, Chandler? Lord. Man, Jesus came to give us life. Try God's way. Try putting him first in your life. Try putting him first in your family. Listen, when you put him first, he'll put you first. Listen, how many got giants in here that they need God to kill in their lives? I wish more than me would raise their hand. Well, let me tell you something. David, under the power of God, took a stone and a sling and killed Goliath. Let me tell you, Jesus, listen, God just rolled the stone away and gave you Jesus so you didn't have to worry about conquering Goliath. Yeah. Yeah, amen. Hallelujah. Thirdly and lastly, is this okay? Some of y'all might be saying, why did the guy holler so much? I don't know. Ask the Lord. Pray for me to give you something to pray about. If you meet my family, you'll understand we're loud. As of right now, I'm the only preacher. But they've got the voice as well. Come on, somebody. Bunch of big mouths out there in them first few rows. I could say that because I are one. Listen to me. Thirdly and lastly, if we're going to get back to the basics, family, we need to understand that the resurrection reveals the life of the Spirit. The resurrection reveals the life of the Spirit. Amen. How many of you know that the Holy Spirit is the agent that changes everything? The Holy Spirit is the one that created everything in creation. He's the one that when God formed man from the dust of the ground and he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. It was the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God that entered into the spirit of man. That created the spirit of man, I should say. Amen. And man was created in God's perfect image and his perfect likeness, the Bible says. Because the Spirit has such power. And can I tell you, for the church too long has looked at people on the outside to determine what they think is going on the inside. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Oh, bless God, I can't believe they're doing that. As you're talking about them. Gossip. Sin. But the Holy Spirit has a very powerful role, and I want to share that with you tonight. Tomorrow, whatever it is. Resurrection reveals the life of the Spirit. Listen to this. John chapter 16 and verse 8. It's about the Holy Spirit's coming and why it's so significant. Why he is so significant. When he has come, he will convict the world of sin. There's something called sin. Right? 2,000 years ago on a cross, Jesus, listen, he paid the price for the sin of humanity. Watch this. And Jesus said, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit once I go away. And when he's come, he'll convict the world of sin. Well, what's that look like, Pastor? Well, to you that knows to do right and you don't do it, to you it's sin. Your conscience tells you, bears witness as to what sin is sometimes. Amen. If you don't know what sin is any more than that, then just go to Galatians chapter 5. For the works of the flesh are evident, which are these. Adultery, fornication, lasciviousness. I mean, I could go on and on. But there's a whole list. Drunkenness, parties, wild parties, orgies. I mean, you name it. It's all in the Bible. The Bible's the greatest book ever written. There's nothing that's not covered in there. It's all covered. Sexuality's covered. Come on. Addictions covered. Whoa, good catch. That's what happens when my face gets sweaty and these glasses are too big. Glasses are still right here. Say, Pastor, you crazy. He's come to convict us of sin. What's that mean? We don't need to tell people what their sin is. The Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit can handle that. Somebody say amen. I know some of y'all don't believe that, and some of y'all don't even like when I preach it. I can see it all over your face. You're going to have to get over it, honey, because this is the gospel. Faces don't scare me, just so you know. I do not scare easily. One of the first things the Lord showed me was when God said to Jeremiah, don't fear their faces. I said, thank you, Lord, I won't, because they're too ugly sometimes. Listen to me. Conviction of sin is the way that God convinces us of what our sin is. That's what conviction of sin is. God convicts us that our way is wrong and His way is right. And we need to understand that sin is still sin in the world, and it still does its damage. It still does its damage to homes. It still does its damage to nations, to communities. Come on, to families. Sin is at the core, and the Holy Spirit is the one that lets people know about their sin. Your job is just to love them. Yeah, not to look down your nose and judge whether they're shacking up or whether they're smoking a pack of Marlboros a day or whether they're going to the dispensary when they leave the church here today. None of that really matters. What matters is that the person that's coming to Christ, that has put their faith in Him, is listening to the voice of the Holy Spirit that is letting them know the plans that He has. And the conviction that He wants to convict them with is a conviction to deliver them from their sins. Because your sins, listen, will always take you further than you want to go. Your sins will always cost you more than you could pay. And your sins will always keep you longer than you'll stay. My God, we don't get a choice of, I could sin and then just come out of it on my own. My God, sometimes when we allow things back in, only God can bring us back out of it. He doesn't leave us or anything. He's always right there. We feel condemned and we feel guilty. Amen. But I want you to know today there's no condemnation in Christ. There's no condemnation. Listen, the Holy Spirit, just listen to the conviction of the Holy Spirit. He'll convict you of your sin. But the good news is, listen to this. He convicts you about your righteousness. What He does is He says, your righteousness is as filthy rags. That's what Isaiah said. Why? Because in the old covenant, the only righteousness they had was to bring an animal to the priest, and he would go in and make a sacrifice, and then their sins were forgiven for a year. But then the next year, they had to bring all them same sins up for that year and for the year they just committed again. Woo! Can you imagine? It would have been impossible for me. They didn't have computers back then. Who am I preaching to? Don't mind the guy counting, okay? Just counting. Jesus. God wants to convict you where your righteousness comes. He wants to convince you that your righteousness isn't anything about you. It's about Jesus, whose life now will live in you. When you become a believer, when you put your faith in Christ and you say no to your sin and say yes to God, watch this. The Holy Spirit comes in and begins to live in your heart. Begins to live in your life. The Bible says that you're given a new heart in that moment. And that's the Holy Spirit's role. He convicts us of sin, but He convicts us of our righteousness. And I'm so thankful that I discovered the gospel in my lifetime, Matt, because I didn't know the full gospel of Jesus Christ. And can I tell you, I can live so much freer now. Why? Because all them years I just hoped that I could be perfect. All the pressure's off anymore. I don't got to try to be perfect. You don't got to try to be perfect. All you've got to try to be is who God created you to be. Listen, His Spirit lives in you. That means He's given you a brand new nature. Come on, when the Holy Spirit comes and He convicts you of sin, and then He convinces you of your righteousness, He's going to convince you of judgment. Why? Because there's nobody left to be judged but the God of this world, is what the text says. The God of this world's already been judged. There's no judgment. It's only, the only thing for you to do is to believe. Y'all, I need you to pray for me. All right, we got to wrap this up. Say, Pastor, bring it in for a landing. I probably am a sweating mess, and if I am, I apologize in advance. You're going to have to get over it. I'm about to die here. There we go. Should have did a praise break. You got it. So, The Holy Spirit is the agent to convict us of our sin. But listen to me. Let him convince you of your righteousness. The Bible says that when we receive the gift of grace, we receive the gift of righteousness. And the Bible says that Paul's writing, he says, you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I don't got to long after and pine after of abstaining from all these things. You know, I mean, we've abstained from everything. We abstained from hair. We abstained from makeup. Thank God we got over that one. We abstained from pants. Women, Sister Barb, what are you doing wearing those pants today? Your generation would not have accepted that, young lady. Let me tell you, it's about Jesus. Because God doesn't look as a man looks on the outward appearance. People look at me sometimes, the way I act, the way I look, I'm mean looking. So I just look mean. I don't know why. I just always got a permanent scowl on my face. I have for my whole life. What you so mad about, bro? Nothing. I love Jesus. Can I tell you that God gave us the way, the life of the Spirit? Romans chapter 8 and verse 11 says this. I read it to you at the beginning. The same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. He dwells in you. He lives in you. Right? Let me read it to you. But if the same Spirit who raised him, Jesus, from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead, which is the Father, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to you. He'll give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. Listen, the letter kills. Quit using your Bible to beat people over the head. It just kills. The letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. Let the Holy Spirit come on you. And under the unction of the Holy Ghost, I dare you to step out in faith when you know it's God under the unction and just tell someone these simple words. God loves you. I don't know how many people that I've never met before and I was nervous when I went to meet them. Oh yeah, I still get nervous when I meet new people. But there's a power in me that's bigger than my nervousness. And I've walked into so many hospital rooms of people that were hopeless and people that were sick and people that were dying of different diseases. And I've had the privilege to pray with them and talk to them and to see some of them healed and some of them to just go be with the Lord. But in that, in those moments, there's been so many times people I absolutely nothing knew nothing about God said, tell them I love them. I just heard it in my spirit. God ain't like this. Tell them. More like, hey, tell them about me. Yeah. That's what he says. Because all we got to do is tell it. Yeah. His Spirit lives in you. The Spirit of God, he'll speak to your heart. He's gentle. He's a gentleman. He's not going to beat you up. It isn't God that beats you down and says, ah, you dirty dog. That's a man. No, that ain't God. God don't do that. Not the God we serve. That may be Allah. Uh-oh, did he say that? I said that. I don't care about this politically quacked world. What a bunch of quacks. I've come to say what God has to say. I've come to be a voice to the nation. I've come to be a voice to the city of Lansing to let the world know that there is a God that loves you. There is a God that no matter what you've done, that God sent his son for the price of the sins of the world. No matter what that sin is, God loves you today. And he doesn't want you to struggle in your sin, but he wants you to live a life that's abundant and it's full. Amen. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. Galatians chapter 5 and verse 16. Let me read this for you. So I say then, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. What's guiding your life? Is it a bottle? Is it the next party? Is it a person? I'm just asking. What's guiding your life? So let the Holy Spirit guide your life, and you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. The sinful nature, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambition, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins like these. Let me tell you again, as I've told you before, that anyone that lives this sort of life won't inherit the kingdom of God. But, remember what I said, but negates everything that was said before. But, the Holy Spirit produces the kind of fruit in our lives, this kind of fruit in our lives, love. Come on, who can't say that you want to be loved more? Every person under the sound of my voice wants to be fully known and fully loved. Fruit of the Spirit, love, joy. Come on. When you experience the love of God, the joy of God has to come along with it. What are you living for? I can look back on my life before Christ and I see God's hand protecting me. And I'm so thankful for that. And some of you shouldn't be here today, but God has kept you. And you may be struggling with sin, but 2,000 years ago, at a cross on the hill of Calvary, the Son of God spread his arms wide and he allowed nails to be pierced through his hands and he allowed his blood to flow to redeem you, to set you free, and to give you a life and to teach. Listen, I'm going to tell you something. I love my family. I've always loved them. But I never could have loved them like I love them today without Jesus. Come on. Amen. The fruit of the Spirit, listen, produces these kind of fruits: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. Patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. There is no law against these things. Amen. Some of you, maybe you're just struggling. Maybe you're struggling with fear. Fear is real in our world today. We live in a fear-consumed world. We live in a fear-driven world. We live in a world where the agenda is fear. I'm telling you. Fear, 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 fear. Listen, fear, listen, 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 fear, 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 fear. Listen, fear comes from the enemy. Listen, 2 Timothy 1:7, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Listen to me, God hasn't given you a spirit of fear, he's given you power. Power, power what? Power over your fear. Hallelujah. Don't be anxious about it. You want to know why there's so many anxious people in the world? Fear. At the root of anxiety is fear. Amen? Amen. But God, when you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, he has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Come on, honey. I got to close. I'm done. We got to move. I'm done. Y'all know me. I keep time well. Why? Because I know some of you, you can only sit here as long as your hind end can endure. Amen. Listen, family. Why don't you stand to your feet with me? As we're here today, I want to ask you, do you know this Jesus? Amen. Do you know this Jesus that I'm preaching to you today? I didn't ask you if you know about him. I didn't ask you if you have heard of him or if you know that he's the Son of God. What I really want to know is, have you surrendered to him? Have you said, God, here I am. My life belongs to you. See, when we lift our hands in this church and worship, that's what we're doing. We're saying, Father, we surrender. Amen. Please go ahead. Hallelujah. God wants your surrender. Where do I start, Pastor? Saying, Jesus, I need you. That's where you start, saying, Jesus, I need you. I know that as I've preached, some of you have listened, some of you have tuned out. But I'm so thankful that God's word says it will not return void, but it will accomplish what he sent it to do. And I want to ask you today, are you tired? Without anybody looking around today, I want to pray for this, every person that's in this house today. And I want to make sure that you know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. Hallelujah. He is so good. I met him 25 years ago this August. 25 years ago, I gave my life to Christ. Hallelujah. Am I perfect? No. Am I changed? Ask them. Ask my family. Ask those closest. I'm going to tell you something. My only regret in life is I didn't make Jesus Lord of my life sooner. With every head bowed and every eye closed, will you bow your heads with me for prayer today, please? I believe the Holy Spirit's power is here in strength. And if you're here today, you'd say, Pastor, I've made so many mistakes, I don't know where to start. Jesus says, just come. He says, come unto me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I'll give you rest. Every head bowed and every eye closed, please. I want to pray. If you would say, Pastor, I want to receive Jesus. I want to turn away from my sin and I want to turn to him. I want you to give me this life that you're talking about. God, my family is struggling. My life is struggling. I've got a smile on, and I put a smile on for everybody, but the smile is just temporary. Who am I preaching to today? God has a plan for you. There's nothing you've done that has made you stop loving him. He loves you. He's crazy about you. Every head bowed and every eye closed. If you need Jesus this morning, you say, Pastor, I'd like to give him my life for the first time. Lift your hands. Is there anybody in the house? Maybe you'd say, Pastor, I've prayed the prayer before, but I want to give my heart to him. I want to rededicate my life to him. I want to receive Jesus today. Is there anybody in this house on Easter Sunday? Today could be your brand new day. Today could be a brand new life for you and your family. Listen, the Bible says that he'll save you and your whole house. I see that hand. God bless that hand. Is there anybody else in the house? Raise your hand. Just slip it up quickly and put it back down. You want to make Jesus Savior? I see that hand. God bless him. Hallelujah. 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 Is there anyone else that would say, Jesus, I see that hand. God bless that hand. Listen, the Lord is here, and he's not mad at you. He just wants you to know he loves you so much, and all you got to do is bring it to him today. Bring your problems. Bring your pain. Bring your past to him. Hallelujah. They're going to start singing this song. I'm going to pray for you. Listen, if you lifted your hand, pray this prayer with me. Say, Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sins. I repent. And right now, Lord, I believe that you died on the cross for me. And I believe that you rose again to give me new life. And right now, I receive your love, your forgiveness, and your life. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to start singing this song. This song talks about the love that God has for you. He's crazy about you. If you need prayer for healing, they're going to start singing. Go ahead. Now. I need my prayer team to come.
Where can
Maybe right where you're at, you need something from the Lord. Just slip up your hand. Loves you today. God, that you, God, would step in the midst of broken situations. Father, I pray in the mighty name of Jesus, God, that you would mend broken hearts today. God, that you would put people back together. God, you are the God that not only saves and redeems from sin, but you're the God that makes us whole. And I pray over marriages. I want whole marriages, restored marriages, renewed marriages, revitalized marriages, God, in the name of Jesus. God, we cancel the assignment of the enemy that's trying to bring divorce over marriages in the name of Jesus. Satan, I bind you in Jesus' mighty name. You have no power. You have no authority here. Hallelujah. I render you powerless, you spirit of division. And And I plead the blood of Jesus over every family, over every home, over every marriage, in Jesus' name. Well, come on, give him a hand clap of praise. Amen, amen. He's worthy of praise today. He's worthy of praise. I know we got to wrap it up. Are we ready out there? Are they ready out there? Yeah. Come on, let's sing this one more time. He loves me. He loves me when I'm alive. Sing it with us.
He loves me when I'm down. Your love surrounds me. I can't get away. You love me when I'm low. You love me when I'm found. Your love surrounds me. I can't get away. No, no, you can't get away. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Give Jesus an ovation of praise. Pastor Keith Williams is going to pray the closing prayer today. We're going to go out. I'm going to meet at the back door back here. I just want to greet you as you leave. I'm the guy that's all jacked up with no clothes on, so just stop by there and see me. But let's stick around. If you got kids, stick around for the Easter egg hunt. It's going to be a blast. Got lots of prizes and candy. And so we'll see you just in a little bit, all right?
Praise the Lord. We're so glad that everyone showed up this morning. And if you didn't get anything else, Jesus loves you. Praise the Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your presence. We thank you for loving us, Lord, when we wasn't lovable. We didn't even care, but you still loved us. And everyone that is here, I ask you, Lord, to bless.